and thank you very much for your invitation to come speak with you. I'm excited to share our research with you today. Let me just load our presentation. Let's see. I wish I could be speaking with you in French, but I don't know if you said I was born and raised in the States, and so I had no exposure to French as I was growing up. I've tried to pick up a little bit as I've moved to Canada, but so far the only phrase that I can say is le cheval ne nage pas, which makes no sense because it's not even true. So that's not going to get us through the presentation, unfortunately. So I will be speaking in English. There's a lot of practical decisions that are made on a day-to-day basis in the correctional system. Is an offender ready to enter into a program? Has an offender made progress? Can we observe this progress? Can we be sure that this progress has occurred throughout incarceration, potentially program involvement? Is the offender ready to re-enter? Parole boards are making these decisions, again, on a daily basis. And then what are the potential complications? What are the potential complications that are in the release plans? And can we pinpoint them ahead of time? And can we prepare for that as the offender is returning to the community? So these practical challenges keep going day in and day out. But underlying this, there are some extreme conceptual challenges that we're faced with because we have to ask ourselves, are these decisions that we're making day to day, are they based on a strong foundation of knowledge? And I would argue to you that our foundation of knowledge isn't strong enough. What do we know about offender change, how offenders are progressing, their motivation, their pathways to success? And all of these decisions hinge on our ability to have sophisticated knowledge about these processes. And again, as I'd argue to you, is that we're just at the beginning of understanding these processes. So the three points that I want to tackle today, the three questions are, when offenders change, what is changing? What are the key elements of this process of change? What does it look like? What are the underlying processes that are driving offenders to become crime-free? And can we reliably assess these things? And so our lab has been tackling these three questions in various ways. The first thing that I'll just address is the question, do offenders change at all? And it's a fair question to start with, do offenders stop committing crimes? And I'm going to summarize in one word a huge body of research or two bodies of research out there and tell you, yes, offenders do change. Part of how we know that is that we've looked at longitudinal evidence and we've seen that over time, once you hit about the age of 25 to 35, all offenders as typically as individuals and most groups of offenders are stopping committing crime. There's very few people who continue committing crime, very small percentage of the population who continue to commit crime beyond the age of about 35. And then there's also this very strong body of research that shows that offender rehabilitation works, that offenders who go through a particular type of rehabilitation programs are reducing their criminal activity. So there is a change process that's going on. But that still leads us to some more sticky questions of can we reliably observe and predict which offenders? We know as a group, offenders who are going through treatment are getting better. But can we pinpoint which ones are the ones changing and how are they changing? And that's the new challenge ahead of us. So the intra-individual factors, the factors that are changing within the person, what are these factors that are changing and how are they driving this change process? So what our lab did recently, and we just found out early last week that this paper's been accepted, we went through a systematic review of three different areas of offender treatment, cognition, violence, and substance misuse. And we wanted to see, are there any variables out there? Are there any measures out there that reliably help us predict who is changing? And the first thing that we notice as we're going through this process is that there's very little information out there. We weren't able to find really enough studies to look at this as systematically as we wanted to. So under the area of cognition, there were 18 significant tests out of only 78 tests that we could find in the literature. Violence and substance misuse were even less. So that first keys us to this idea that we need to know a lot more about this. So all of these studies that we're looking at, specifically, they measured change at least two times, or they measured the same variable at least two times and looked at the change between that, and then associated that change between time one and time two to recidivism. So it's a more rigorous test than, so that's why it narrowed down very quickly. So what did we find? Those of you who are familiar with the correctional area, especially Andrews and Bonta's work, will notice that the large effects were for things that we consider to be dynamic risk factors. You're seeing criminal peers, criminal cognition, hostility, perceived problems, negative emotionality, negative affect, social support, family problems. We're all predicting with large effect that changes in these variables were predicting who reoffended and who did not reoffend. Some lower effects were stress, some other beliefs about crime, and LSIR scores, which is a dynamic risk assessment. Things that we're not predicting were the same things that we're predicting. And so what that's telling us is that in some samples, some measures are doing better than others. But crime cognition and attitude scales were looked at systematically, but only a few of them were actually doing the work of predicting, where a lot of them were coming up with null effects. So that tells us that only a minority are actually predicting, even though, and we aren't able to see when some measures are predicting well and when they aren't. For the violence area, the only significant predictors that came out was skill knowledge. People who are changing, doing better during programs were changing and not recidivating at such a high rate. And then the medium effects were anger and problem insight, where impulsivity didn't predict at all. Change in impulsivity wasn't associated. Again, we're only looking at 7 tests total, and only 4 out of those were significant. Then substance misuse, potentially unsurprisingly, but nicely, we see that substance use and changes in substance use intra-individually were the things that were predicting recidivism, lower recidivism for those people who reduce their substance use. And then some general negative symptomatology, such as anxiety and depression, seemed to also have a small effect. But employment and attitudes didn't seem to have an effect at all. So what is changing? And we can kind of sit back a little bit and say, okay, this is confirming what our research has been suggesting to us, that changes in what we consider to be important dynamic risk factors on an intra-individual level within the person are predicting. Some nice things that came out of this review that haven't been highlighted so much is this idea of successful treatment process. So that's something that we can focus on in the future in terms of how people change through the treatment itself. If they get it during the treatment, seems to be an important factor in not recidivating later. And then the other thing that was a bit surprising or came out of this review that we didn't necessarily expect was the idea of situational negative affect, that people who are having a really negative emotions while they're in the community, these people were also more likely to recidivate. So changes in increases in negative affect are an important thing for us to look at as well in terms of change. But again, I really want to emphasize, we're looking at a very small number of studies here that gave us what we were looking for. So the bottom line is that we have to look at it and realize we've been satisfied with indirect evidence of change. We don't have this direct evidence in the literature showing us that when so-and-so, Mr. X, changes in this fashion on this variable, we can reliably associate that with changes in his behavior, his or her behavior. So we've just been looking at treatment groups as a whole and not going to this individual level, and arguably we'll be able to make much better decisions in the correctional system if we're able to take our research in that direction. So there's a lack of studies that are looking at this, and then there's a lack of reporting of the information as well. We found even in studies that looked at this systematically weren't giving us everything we needed to code well for the studies. So there's a lot of space left here. Essentially, there's this huge area where we need a better longitudinal understanding of change, not just in treatment as well, but it would be very valuable to understand change across more of the life course, but then also from the beginning of the prison sentence all the way throughout into the community, where many of these studies are just looking at a very short period of time in the treatment program, where arguably a lot more variables are coming into play besides just during that treatment period. So that the second point keys into that is that we need a more comprehensive understanding of change. We're looking at what's going on in the community, what's going on in the offender internally and externally beyond the treatment program as well. And arguably this research, this systematic review taught us or revealed to us that we probably need more sophisticated concepts when it comes to understanding change, that we've been looking at it very much in a scratch the surface sort of way. Our theory of change is essentially there's a risk factor goes down, behavior changes. Where our understanding of human development and human change would suggest that there's a lot more to it than that, that there's probably interactions between different variables, internal and external, are all coming together. So we need more sophisticated understanding of change, and that means better concepts, and then arguably better measures as well, where many of the measures that were used in these studies were not looked at or were not created in order to find the fine-tuned changes that people go through. And so we need measures that are more attuned to how people change. So that's something we've been looking at in our lab. So the model that we're looking at that Dr. Ralph Sarin and I have been developing looks kind of like this. So it's a nice little picture. We have what we call the age crime curve. And so research consistently shows that as offenders, as individuals get older across time, criminal activity goes up and then drops down. And again, I said the peak is about between the ages of 18 to 25 is when criminal activity is peaking and then dropping down. And research shows that about 70% of offenders follow some kind of pattern of this increasing and then decreasing. At the front end, we want to pay attention to the research that suggests that these risk factors are extremely important as people are getting involved in crime. Younger people are more likely to get involved in crime. Those with antisocial attitudes, antisocial personality, a history of antisocial behavior, peers who are antisocial, substance misuse. So these things are at the front end, but then at the back end, there's a nice body of research that consistently shows that as offenders age, as they get into high quality marriages, consistent, stable employment, as their views about crime change, so that the cost of crime seems subjectively to be worse than the rewards of crime, substance sobriety, they get involved in good relationships. All these variables seem to be taking place as offenders desist out of crime. So then that leads us to this question of what's going on in the middle. What is this change process? And what we would argue to you is that there has to, at the very least, be a commitment to change, that offenders aren't going to just randomly find their way into a change process, but they're going to have to be committed to doing something different. But we also think that commitment isn't enough, that you can be committed all the day long, but there's going to be challenges. And so certain other factors are going to have to come into play to sustain that commitment beyond just, I'm never going to prison again, but really wanting to put effort into this. So the internal change factors that we're paying attention to from the literature are things like self-efficacy or agency, this belief that, yes, I can make the changes that I want to make. Attributions, how do you view crime in your life? Who caused crime? Is it you yourself? Or did other experiences in your life cause you to get involved in crime? Outcome expectancies, what do you believe will happen if you commit crime again? Good things, bad things. And then several theories. Shad Maruna really started this area by looking very carefully at identity. There's also Giordano has a theory called cognitive transformation theory and looking at how people change their identity, where they see, I'm not an offender anymore, I am now an ex-offender. And that kind of view of yourself changing seems to be important in the middle of this process. And then also beliefs about change. If you're trying to make a big change in your life, do you understand it's going to take effort, or is it going to just happen overnight? And so these types of beliefs seem to be important as well. But the internal factors are only part of the story, where we would never presume that someone who kind of had all of their ideas put together, if they didn't have opportunities, It's going to be very challenging. And so opportunities are a very important aspect of this too, where people who get access to good correctional intervention, who have proactive supervision, aftercare, positive relationships in a supportive community, the types of things that the reentry literature looks at, you know, what helps people as they return to the community post-prison. These things are likely to be at play as well in this process. And so we think that these two things really are working together, that it's not just the internal and it's not just the external, but the two interact to drive this process. And the internal change factors are going to support that commitment to change, and the external change factors are going to support their opportunities to actually enact their desire to give up crime. So that's the model that we're working with. The key, just to review, the key factors are those risk factors, the desistance correlates, the internal change factors, and then reentry concerns. And so we've taken this various literature and tried to put it together to look at it more systematically. So two just brief studies that we've looked at in our lab. The first one, we're interested in really confirming this model that there are these two processes going on, the increase in risk factors and then the decrease during the desistance. So we looked at a measure that Daryl Kroner, who's supposed to be here soon, created with his colleague, the MCAD, and then we created some new measures with a different sample to look at these, at the concepts that I was talking about when I was saying internal. This is a whole bunch of numbers, but I'll just boil it down to one statement to say that basically what's going on here in these various areas of their lives, offenders are saying different things are going on. Different things are going on in my life when I'm giving up crime than when I'm getting into crime. And so all of these significant t-tests at the end are saying that they're reporting very different experiences. So that really confirms those first two boxes at the bottom there, that offenders themselves recognize that the factors that kind of snare me up as I'm trying to stay crime-free are different from the things that really hook me into a crime-free life. So that's a nice little finding. And then we just got some follow-up data for this as well. And nicely, when we're looking at a survival analysis to see who actually, after this study, was able to stay crime-free, what they talked about in terms of resource availability, and that's those constructs are just things of the resources that they have in the community that help them, the people, the jobs, those types of items, that when they talked about those things and how it interacted with them at risk situations, didn't predict. But when they were saying things like, when I have these resources in my life, it helps me to stay crime-free, that measure actually did predict, even when we're controlling for static risk measures. So that tells us that even as we look forward into the future, after people have reported, that it's the desistance variables that seem to be to having some predictive power, that the things that are getting them out of crime are the things that are predicting their post-release success, where their thoughts about risk were not predicting in the same way. That's kind of a nice little dichotomy that we were seeing. A similar finding that just came out of our lab, this project I wasn't as involved in, so I'm just reporting from what I've talked about with others, but we're looking at this measure called the Dynamic Risk Assessment for Offender Reentry, the DRAOR, which has been implemented in a couple of places in the States. And what they're finding is that when parole officers were looking at these various factors on a week-to-week basis, I believe it was every 2 weeks that they were measuring, that it did predict above and beyond our static risk measures. We were seeing that kind of what's going on in the offender's life in that moment is helping us understand who's at risk to offend over the next 2 weeks. So the AUCs, the statistics were significant for that. They were mild, but we would probably expect that based on we're looking at a very short time period. And so static risk usually predicts stronger, but we're still seeing above static risk that this measure is predicting. But kind of what's most important for this point in the talk is this idea that the protective desistance factors that we're looking at in this DRAOR measure, we're having the best predictive validity. So again, that message that seems to be coming across from these data is that the protective factors, the strengths that the offender has in his life, is what's actually driving the change from a week-to-week process, which is nice to see. So our second study that I'll just go through briefly, we created some new measures, and nicely what we saw is that these measures were clustering together, were correlating together in exactly the way that theory would suggest would happen. And so we had a measure of agency, and that was positively correlated with beliefs that bad things are gonna happen to you if you commit more crimes. So people who are devaluing crime are also believing that they can give up crime if they want to. They also seem to understand that there's this, it's going to take effort. The same people who believe that they can go through this process are the people who understand it's not going to happen overnight. They're going to have to put some effort into it. And these people are also conversely valuing, they devalue crime, but they value desistance. They say good things are going to happen to me if I try to give up crime. And then similarly, it's negatively correlated or inversely correlated with belief that good things are going to happen if I continue to commit crime, or that bad things are going to happen to me if I try to give up crime. So we're seeing this nice clustering where some offenders seem very poised and ready to give up crime, while other offenders are planning to get back involved in crime. So we also looked at recidivism outcome for here, looking at these different measures. The beliefs about change seemed to, when we looked at the area under the curve, were the strongest, but when we looked at the survival analysis, also the crime expectancies seemed to be really driving the process of people, their beliefs about crime really strongly predicted more than desistance expectancies, whether they would give up. And that was true, it was approaching significance when we looked at controlling for static risk. We see with the crime expectancies, but not the desistance expectancies, that it seems to be driving the process. So yeah, in summary there, from this data set, it seems that it's the beliefs about crime and not necessarily their beliefs about the process that are predicting recidivism. This is in contrast to the first studies that I was looking at. And so we have a bit of a mixed message. So I think at this point, kind of the main conclusion that we can draw from this, as is repeated recently, is that we shouldn't throw the baby out with the bathwater in term, is there a French phrase for that? Is that just an English thing? Yeah. I don't know, throwing the baby out with the bathwater. So the idea of, there is a lot of literature out there saying, let's replace kind of our risk conception and put only strength factors. And so our research is nicely showing that strengths are important. They do, in some contexts, seem to predict quite nicely and above and beyond risk. But certainly it's not a matter of one over the other, because in other work, we're looking at the risk, the beliefs about crime is much more important than the beliefs about desistance. So we don't want to minimize the importance of a risk and need model because it has great value for correctional work, but we think that it can be complemented certainly on an individual level, on a case-based level, looking at the strengths that offenders bring too. Limitations, especially for that last study. Ralph would hate it if he knew I was saying this, but it was a bit of a wonky sample. We didn't quite get a very representative sample there. It skewed older and was, yeah, just there's some evidence that it wasn't a typical correctional sample. So we'd like to look at this, at these concepts with a different sample that's more representative, and we've since refined the measurement as well for that cluster that I showed you. Some of the measures did not work as well, and offenders really didn't like some of our items, so we started to move things around and refine that for our future work. So implications for practice based on this research. I think the main message that we're trying to give is that we need to broaden our understanding of change at the individual level. Instead of just looking at how groups are moving through treatment, try to understand how offenders at an individual level are moving in change. Also attend to different desistance concepts than we've been attending to before, to look more systematically at strengths seems to be important. And first, we just need to start measuring as well change at an individual level. As I showed in the initial review, there's very little there for us to hang our hat on. We think that these new measures have potential to organize how we work on a case-based level. That paying attention to strengths, paying attention to the acute dynamic risk factors will help how we organize offenders on probation or parole. And I think it's definitely warranted for us to pay attention to protective factors and desistance factors, given the research that is showing us that they can have predictive validity above static. So our ongoing projects, we are moving in this direction with three main projects in this particular area in our lab. I think you were mentioning the National Institute of Justice study, which we're proud that they were interested in implementing that. CSC is also looking at some of these concepts with our measures in program evaluation. And then we have a community project as well with a reentry sample that we're working on to further test the measures and outcomes associated with it. So that's my presentation. Any questions? Yes.
I really like that last graph that you presented. And I like the way that the positive and negative crime expectancies linked up with the agency.
Yes.
I'm just wondering, how do you measure the negative and positive crime expectancies?
Yes. We're happy with that measure because offenders created it themselves, essentially. We had an open-ended question from another study where we asked them to essentially report anything that they could think of good things that would happen to them or bad things that would happen to them if they committed another crime or if they tried to stay crime-free. So we have about 30 items for each that we took, kind of the most common ones. I'm sorry? We took the items and then we put it on a 7-point scale from very likely to happen to not likely to happen at all, and then kind of took that and created a measure out of it instead of just an open-ended.
So what kind of stuff comes up?
Oh, you're going to make me think hard on this one. Okay. The positive stuff in terms of the crime or the desistance? Impressing people. I'll impress people. I'll get what I want. I'll make more money if I commit more crimes. Again, there's about 30 of those.
The more points they get, the higher they go up in the scale?
Yeah, we want to look at that more systematically, and that's why after we've revised it a little bit, and we'd like a larger sample to do a factor analysis to actually see how that's all working, and if it even if the items are clustering the way we think that they are. So that's the next step for sure. Thanks for your question. Yeah.
Sorry, I missed the beginning of the presentation. So maybe I talked about it, but the question goes like this. You talked about the offenders as being a general group.
Mm-hmm.
How would you expect different groups, and I mean vastly different types of offenders, would be, you know, how you can, your model can approach these. And I'm particularly interested in guys that are not, say, bad guys or sick or whatever, just
yep.
like the normal car thief who makes yep. some money out of it. And so how do you plan to see all those differences?
I think that's an open question at this point. There's very little research to give us an idea of how different types of offenders go through this change process. The one thing that we were able to do, about half the sample had a violent offense that they're incarcerated for, and half it was a nonviolent offense. So we tried to look at the correlations for the two separately, and they're essentially the same. There are very little differences. The trouble with that is that with a CSC population, pretty much even all of the nonviolent offenders had a violent offense sometime in their past. And so it was a bit of a false dichotomy to look at it that way. But I think that's a great area of exploration, and we need more looking at, do sex offenders change differently? Do drug offenders change in a different way? And arguably they do, but we're at such an early stage that I can't answer that at this point. But yeah, thank you.